What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you're having a fantastic Wednesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing I want to talk about today is a story, actually, stories over the past few weeks that it feels like common sense that this whole situation's a whole lot of no, but apparently it is not that common. And that is a story that's revolving around the kids from Stranger Things. You may have already seen the news. Allie Michael, a 27-year-old model, recently came under fire because she was hitting on Finn Wolfhard. Finn, of course, an actor on Stranger Things. He is also 14 years old. She posted a photo of him to her Instagram story with the caption, "Not to be weird, but hit me up in 4 years, Finn." And after that, there was a lot of backlash, people saying, "Why are you hitting on a child?" She then responded by posting another photo to her Instagram saying, "Hi, yesterday I posted a picture of Mike from Stranger Things and wrote, 'Call me in 4 years.' It was completely and absolutely a joke, but I understand that people have been offended by it. It was wrong to joke about it, and I apologize. I do not want Mike from Stranger Things to call me. I hope this clears things up." Now, at this point, I do want to point out that in general, in our society, there is a double standard when it comes to men and women, boys and girls. Now keep in mind, I am not saying that double standard is okay. Why I mention that is because before you're about to do something, it's sometimes best to just reverse the roles. So with like the Finn situation, reverse those roles. I do feel like it is unfortunate that I have to say, you know, switch the roles so you can understand how fucking creepy this is. But historically, I have found that that has the highest rate of success for getting people to understand. Example, some guys I know initially responded to this situation going, "Oh man, if I was Finn, I would fucking love this." Hell yeah. But where does your mind go if I, a 31-year-old man, decide to post a picture of Millie Bobby Brown, a 13-year-old actress from Stranger Things? It's just so weird. I can't even finish the sentence. It's creepy. I don't even like creating this fake scenario to help people understand. If I said, "Call me in 5 years, that would be the most fucking disgusting thing ever. That is a child that you're talking about. And I'm mentioning this not so Allie Michael's career gets ruined, but so that this can become an educational experience. People can learn from it, grow from it, be better people. Additionally, there's also another thing I want to hit on with Finn. He was recently criticized for being rude to fans. There were fans outside of his hotel. They were asking for an autograph or a picture. He said no. And there was one specific guy on Twitter that posted a video of Finn walking past them, and he included the caption, "Imagine being 14 and heartless that you can't even stop for your fans who made you famous in the first place. Wow." And so to that, I say, Chandler, buddy, pal, imagine being a grown-ass man waiting outside of a child's hotel and then somehow make him the bad guy. Maybe he's running late for something, maybe he needs to get some sleep, maybe he doesn't want to encourage this behavior, maybe he has anxiety. Also, the "your fans who made you famous" thing, I think you're giving yourself a little bit too much credit there, Chandler. Unless, and I'll take it back if it's the case, unless you were the one that cast him in Stranger Things. But if that's not the case, then Chandler, that child that you're definitely not stalking doesn't owe you anything. And this is something other actors also chimed in on. Shannon Purser, who played Barb in season one, writing, "Okay, no actor is under any obligation to stop for anyone. Finn is an incredibly kind human, but he's human and he needs breaks too. I experience this on a significantly smaller scale, obviously, but I've had people waiting for me in hotel lobbies, at my airport gate, etc. And I'm an adult. I can't imagine being inundated with all this attention at his age. It's intimidating. So from one big sister to the world, don't you dare make young actors feel guilty or indebted to you because they couldn't say hi. They give you their art, they love their fans, don't take advantage of that. And if you can't handle them needing space, stay away." Also, Sophie Turner, who of course plays Sansa Stark on Game of Thrones, writing, "Damn, seeing fully grown adults wait outside the Stranger Things kids' hotels, etc., and then abuse them when they don't stop for them is super weird. A, what adult in their right mind waits for a child outside their hotel, and B, is then offended when the child doesn't stop? It doesn't matter if they are an actor, they are kids first. Give them the space they need in order to grow without feeling like they owe anyone anything for living their childhood dreams. Oh, and P.S. Imagine you are a parent walking with your 13-year-old son/daughter and seeing a fully grown adult pointing their camera phone at your kid. You would do anything you could to delete that person's photograph and remove your child from that situation as soon as you could. It doesn't matter if that child happens to be an actor and consented to a professional film crew capturing their moves when in character. That does not mean that this child consented to being followed around with a camera in their face. I don't care if it, quote, comes with the job. It doesn't." And so I guess the main point of the story is, can people stop being weird and creepy?
That would be so cool.
That said, I am just one person. Maybe you have a different opinion. I would love to hear yours. Do you agree? Do you disagree? Why? I'd love to know your thoughts. But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today and today in Awesome, brought to you by SeatGeek. SeatGeek, of course, a fantastic ticket app that takes the confusion out of buying tickets. They put all the tickets in one place, give them 0 to 100 scores, so you know if you're getting a good deal or not. I have the app on my phone, and it is by far the easiest way to buy a ticket to a game, a concert, a whatever. So if you want to make the smart move like many from the nation already have, click that link in the description down below to download the app. And remember to use code PHIL to get $20 off your first ticket purchase. And the first bit of awesome, I guess funny enough, is the honest trailer for Stranger Things. Then a cool and just kind of random video was a video from Wired. They went inside Keanu Reeves' custom motorcycle shop. Then we got a new Binging with Babish. It shows you how to make a triple-decker ego extravaganza. Also to everyone that keeps tweeting to me, yes, I did see the Binging with Babish throwing down the gauntlet. I do think a Ghost Pepper challenge is a bit ridiculous because I just did one on the secondary channel, but it's for charity and I will accept it. We got Video Game Donkey covering Sonic Forces. Also, as an aside, I just gotta give some creator on creator love. Video Game Donkey is just one of those channels that it's consistently good. I genuinely get excited when he posts new videos. And then the final bit of awesome, you know, actually it's gonna be the secret link of the day. If you're hungry, maybe you care about the secret link. And if you wanna see the full versions of everything, I just shared the secret link of the day, anything at all. Links as always are in the description down below. And then let's talk about this pretty ridiculous story involving Disney and the LA Times. You may have seen the news recently that the Walt Disney Company banned the Los Angeles Times from advanced film screening. Now that by itself, at the top level, kind of a non-story, but when you look into why they did it, that is why I feel so many people care about it and why I want to talk about it on my show. So why the ban? Well, the tension between the LA Times and Disney stems from a recently published report. In September, the LA Times published an extensive two-part investigative piece detailing the business relationship between the Walt Disney Company and the city of Anaheim. Anaheim is the host city of Disneyland's California parks. And the piece reported on financial subsidies and incentives Anaheim provides Disney. Disney, after all, is its largest employer, taxpayer, and charitable contributor. For example, the article claims that Anaheim leases a parking garage with more than 10,000 spaces to the Disney Company for just $1 per year. And reportedly, that garage costs $108 million of taxpayer money. The piece also covering Disney-backed candidates for Anaheim City Council, the city granting Disney a tax rebate for its luxury hotels, this estimated to be around $267 million in the favor of Disney. And there's a lot more. If you want to check it out, I'll link to those full articles down below. So then fast forward to last Friday. Two editor notes appeared in the LA Times that caught a lot of attention. The paper had published its annual holiday movie preview that features films from major studios across Hollywood, but one major studio was missing, and that studio was Disney. And in an editor's note, the paper explained, "The annual holiday movie sneak section published by the Los Angeles Times typically includes features on movies from all major studios, reflecting the diversity of films Hollywood offers during the holidays, one of the busiest box office periods of the year. This year, Walt Disney Co. Studios declined to offer the Times advanced screening, citing what it called unfair coverage of its business ties with Anaheim. The Times will continue to review and cover Disney movies and programs when they are available to the public." And additionally, a very similar note was placed in the day's calendar section to explain why there was no review of Thor Ragnarok. Then later, when asked for comment about the decision, the Walt Disney Company responded, "We regularly work with news organizations around the world that we don't always agree with. But in this instance, the LA Times showed a complete disregard for basic journalistic standards. Despite our sharing numerous indisputable facts with the reporter, several editors, and the publisher over many months, the Times moved forward with a biased and inaccurate series, wholly driven by a political agenda. So much so that the Orange County Register referred to the report as a hit piece with a, quote, seemingly predetermined narrative. We've had a long relationship with the LA Times, and we hope they will adhere to balanced reporting in the future." But in response to that, Daniel Miller, who reported on the September story, tweeted, "Disney never asked for a correction. Read the story for yourself." Also, we saw many film critics and reporters outraged by this decision. Online arts and culture magazine FlavorWire taking a stand and encouraging other outlets to do the same, writing, "For as long as Disney locks out the Los Angeles Times, this outlet will withhold the only thing we have of value to that studio, the free advertising provided by not only reviewing their films, but write-ups of their trailers, production announcements, casting rumors, and so on." And Jason Bailey, the site's film editor, went on to call Disney's move petty and noted that the Times writers also had their access removed from Disney TV sites like ABC and ESPN. We then saw more and more critics, more and more sites coming out saying that they will not go or cover Disney movies. Pop culture site AV Club writing, "It's a dangerous precedent that Disney is setting. Write an unfavorable story, one that Disney hasn't disputed factually even, and it will blacklist your publication, punishing independent journalism by using its massive corporate influence." Then, earlier this week, four major film critic groups announced they had voted to disqualify Disney films from their year-end awards consideration. This until they reversed their ban on the Times. One of the things I really agreed with was one of the statements that came from the Boston Globe on this. They wrote, "We understand that access is not a right. It is, however, fundamental to a high-functioning free press and should never be broadly denied as a form of punishment." But after all of the backlash, all the boycott announcements, the New York Times reported that Disney had finally backed down. And Disney later confirmed its decision with a statement saying, "We've had productive discussions with the newly installed leadership of the Los Angeles Times regarding our specific concerns, and as a result, we've agreed to restore access to advanced screenings for their film critics." And shortly afterward, the Times also released a statement saying, "The Los Angeles Times has covered the Walt Disney Company since its founding here in Los Angeles in 1923. We look forward to reporting on Disney well into the future." And my personal takeaway from those statements is it looks like the LA Times is letting Disney limp this one off. We talked to newly installed leadership about our concerns. They heard us out. That's all we wanted. We just wanted a fair shot, even though it doesn't look like Disney called for any corrections or clarifications publicly. I haven't seen Disney's statement of what was factually incorrect. And ultimately, this story was at a point where Disney had everything to lose and nothing to gain. And the final note I'll leave this story on is the whole reason I'm even talking about this is story suppression. You have a big guy trying to punish a news outlet for something that they put out there into the world. They decide to punish that organization not only as payback, but most likely to give a statement to the entire community. You put something out that we don't don't like, you cut off. And we'll keep talking about it on this show until, I don't know, the old guys in boardrooms finally understand, or eventually they die off. When you try to hide something, you try to suppress something, especially by trying to hurt or punish others, all you're doing is making it so that people like myself become even more interested in the story, and then we share it, like, once again in the links down below, because that's just how it works. And then let's talk about the elections in the United States yesterday, because the Democrats did something I didn't know they were able to do anymore. They won. I mean, obviously not everything, but they won a lot more than people expected. Now, before moving forward, it's important to note that there were elections outside of New Jersey and Virginia, but that is the main focus here. There were also smaller elections and referendums in Utah, New York, Maine, Ohio. But seemingly, the biggest statements from people came in New Jersey and Virginia. Now, understand, in New Jersey, there wasn't a big flip. The Democrats here already held a very strong majority in both houses of the state legislature. Still, they picked up 2 seats in the state assembly, 1 seat in the state senate. But the big shift is, in New Jersey, the Democrats now have the trifecta. And so what that means is they now have control of the assembly, senate, and governorship. Democrat Philip Murphy beating Republican Lieutenant Governor Kim Guadagno. Now, some people have stated that this is a big shift because of attitudes changing towards Trump. And granted, here, I think you could argue that, but I think this is far more representative of people just not liking Chris Christie. I mean, we talked about it in October. Chris Christie, the governor of New Jersey, had an approval rating of 15%. And so I think when people saw Kim Guadagno, despite her trying to have some sort of separation, they still saw Chris Christie's lieutenant governor. But where you could easily argue that there is pushback against Trump and Republicans is in Virginia. And Virginia is one of the more interesting states to talk about as far as voting. It's historically a battleground state. There have also been a lot of eyes on Virginia, of course, because of the Charlottesville protests. And so eyes were on Virginia. What was going to happen in the races for the House of Delegates and the governorship? And wow, it ended up being a huge win for Democrats. And just so you understand how big of a win this was, all 100 seats in the House of Delegates were open. Right, and prior to the election, Republicans had a 66 to 34 majority over Democrats. But post-election, as of right now, the Democrats have the lead 49 to 47. They picked up at least 15 seats, and 4 of those remaining seats are just too close to call right now. So as of recording this video, we don't know if the Democrats are gonna get the majority. We don't know if all 4 go to the Republicans, so they still hold the majority. I mean, there's also the very real possibility of a 50-50 split. And while as a whole, this is a big statement, there are also all of these smaller statements that we saw in individual races. For example, Danica Rome. She just became the first openly trans person to ever be elected to a state legislature in American history. But the victory seemed even more meaningful to her supporters because of who she was up against. She was running against Republican Bob Marshall. Bob Marshall is an ardent Trump supporter. He called himself the chief homophobe of Virginia. He also wrote Virginia's controversial bathroom ban bill, that being the bill that would ban trans people from using the bathroom of the gender they identify with. And Rome's win was a huge upset. Bob Marshall was a 26-year incumbent, and she did it with more than 10% of the vote, and it seems to be because she had a focus campaign. A campaign that seemed to be not about who she was, but that she wanted to focus on issues like schools, funding, zoning. Meanwhile, Marshall and the GOP were putting out attack ads against Danica. One reading, Danica Rome in his own words, Danica Rome, born male, has made a campaign issue out of transitioning to female. And there was a lot of criticism around that ad for misgendering Danica, for a group that seems to bash identity politics using identity politics. And seemingly with this vote, the majority of people let Bob Marshall know how they felt. But with all of that said, my favorite thing about this story is the aftermath. Reportedly after the election, after Danica Rome had won, she was asked to comment on Bob Marshall. And she said, quote, I don't attack my constituents. Bob is my constituent now. That is somehow both gracious and extremely damaging. Because that response says both, you know, I'm putting the past and the attacks against me behind me, but that's also because I took your job, Bob. Ain't that a bitch? And then let's talk about Democrat Chris Hurst's win over a 6-year Republican incumbent. And if you're wondering why Chris's name might sound familiar, we actually talked about him 2 years ago. You might remember in 2015, a TV host by the name of Allison Parker was killed live on television. She was shot and killed by a disgruntled ex-employee. It came out after that Chris was her boyfriend. And so after that horrible killing, Chris, who was also an anchor at the time, he decided to dedicate himself to figuring out the causes of and fighting gun violence, saying shortly after the tragedy, her father wants me to help him do whatever it takes to make sure not one more family has to go through this kind of unspeakable violence. If that means talking about gun reform to reduce gun violence, or if that means talking about increasing access to mental health care and trying to figure out how those who have an illness get the care they need, we will do whatever it takes. And true to his word, gun violence was one of the cores of his campaign. And of course, on top of the huge wins in the House of Delegates, they also managed to pick up the governorship. Lieutenant Governor Ralph Northam beating out Republican Ed Gillespie. And more than just beating him, Northam stunned pollsters when he won by more than 9 points. And like we've seen with the past few elections, many people are trying to tie these elections to Trump's approval ratings. Are people pushing back against Trump? If Trump's saying vote for someone, are they doing it? Like I said, many people seeing what happened in Virginia as a pushback against Trump. But following Gillespie's loss, it looked like Trump threw him to the curb. Trump tweeting, Ed Gillespie worked hard but did not embrace me or what I stand for. Don't forget, Republicans won 4 out of 4 House seats, and with the economy doing record numbers, we will continue to win even bigger than before. Although there's been pushback against this statement statement with people saying, well, what about those Trump Gillespie signs? Or the fact that he retweeted your support of him on Twitter? And the candidate that lost was still the candidate you were promoting on your Twitter. When you wrote, Ralph Northam will allow crime to be rampant in Virginia. He's weak on crime, weak on our great vets, anti-Second Amendment. Ed Gillespie will totally turn around the high crime and poor economic performance of Virginia. MS-13 and crime will be gone. Vote today, ASAP. And then, you know what? Let's say that Gillespie didn't fully embrace Trump. That really shouldn't be a shock. Those connections were very likely to hurt him in Virginia. Statewide, in Virginia, the approval rating for Trump is 39%. In a battleground state that was charged up to vote, that connection was probably more damaging than it was beneficial. I mean, I'm not saying it's like getting a Chris Brown endorsement at a Rihanna concert bad, but it's still bad. I mean, I'm sure there are some people that would love that endorsement, but you gotta know your audience. But with that said, that's where we are right now. But the really interesting thing to me is what happens moving forward. Is this the beginning of the Democrats getting some momentum? Most likely, Republicans seeing that they can bleed politically, that's going to ramp them up too. I don't know, but it will be interesting to watch. But that said, that is where I'm going to end today's show. And of course, with this being the Philip DeFranco Show, whether you want to comment on the last story, the first one, anything in between, I'd love to know what you're thinking in those comments down below. And remember, if you liked this video, you like what I try and do on this channel, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button. Also, if you missed yesterday's Philip DeFranco Show, you want to catch up, click or tap right there to watch that. Or if you want to see today's brand new behind the scenes video, click or tap right there to watch that. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.